One line. Let it front. Parade.
Battery. Tense. Hot. Gunners move forward. Low one rod. Two.
There are only two occasions when the cannon of the Military District of Washington fire a 50-gun salute to the nation. Each 4th of July to celebrate the country's birth, and after the death of a President of the United States.
Stand by. Fire.
I do not run for the office of the presidency after 14 years in the Congress with any expectation that it is an empty or an easy job. I run for the presidency of the United States because it is the center of action. And in a free society, the chief responsibility of the president is to set before the American people the unfinished public business of our country.
Of all White House occupants, none has been more confident of his right to live there than John Fitzgerald Kennedy. He has fought hard for it. With his Boston-bred accent, his darting wit, and ringing political challenges, he has brought a new generation to rule. Inaugurated at 43, he accepted power as if this were his natural destiny. He enjoys being president. With his gently spoken, radiant wife, he has brought a new excitement to the pillared mansion on Pennsylvania Avenue. A nation of neighbors discreetly watches its spirited first family, smiles at children bouncing across the barriers of protocol. To the serious tasks of government, he has brought men keen and hard and in a hurry. He makes demands of himself and of the country. In those icy moments when the president confronted Soviet power over Cuba, the people stood as one behind him. But now, in the fall of 1963, as he summons the nation to fulfill its constitutional pledges to the Negro, threatening rifts have begun to appear. From the South have come angry mutterings, even sporadic violence. Yet, facing a new election within a year, the president somehow must seek to secure the votes of at least two of the larger southern states. He well knows his tenure of this lonely eminence rests with the people. In mid-November, the president's plans to inspect military installations, first in Florida, then in Texas, are revealed by Press Secretary Pierre Salinger. Also scheduled are speeches and motorcade tours through five cities in each state. Hopefully, some new votes can be won along the route. On Saturday, November 16th, 6 days before the president's visit, Dallas papers publish his probable route. It will take the president through the downtown streets to the huge trademark building where he will address 2,500 luncheon guests. As always, Secret Service agents have taken elaborate precautions. They have reviewed the trademark guest list and employee roster, studied possible danger points, will even inspect table decorations. They have approved the main court for the gathering, but reluctantly. Its balconies offer an excellent perch for an assassin. Officially notified on November 13th of President Kennedy's impending visit, Dallas police detectives check on all known extremist organizations and individuals. In cooperation with the Secret Service and other government agencies, Deputy Chief Ray H. Lundy makes a detailed inspection of hazards along the motorcade route. An airport fence is removed so the president's car can avoid a busy parking lot. Each bridge, grade crossing, and intersection will be guarded by a patrolman and trains rescheduled to keep tracks clear. Two policemen will be assigned to larger bridges, such as the Triple Underpass, through which the motorcade must go en route to the trademark. Amid all efforts, police are unaware that a new shipping clerk was hired last month at the nearby Texas Book Depository. His name, Lee Harvey Oswald. Since mid-October, under the assumed name of O.H. Lee, he has lived alone in a cheap bedroom in a rooming house on North Beckley near downtown Dallas. His landlady knows him as a clean, quiet tenant. She little suspects his troubled, shadowy past, or that he lives most weekends with his Russian-born wife and two children in an outlying suburb. In Florida, this mid-November weekend, President Kennedy watches the firing of a Polaris missile, visits his ailing father, then sets to work winning votes. In Tampa, Monday, November 18th, for one of five speeches in 9 hours, the president, as usual, moves ahead of his hovering guards to make contact with the crowd. The Secret Service watches anxiously, but the waiting throngs love it. So does the president. For all his alleged aloofness, he enjoys the rude demands of politics and can even take an irreverent delight in its time-honored rituals. Texas Prairie, the lights of Dallas sequin the night. Opulent center of oil fortunes, city of smart shops and elegantly dressed women, she proudly calls herself Big D. But her civic glitter has been tarnished by the occasional behavior of fanatic fringe groups. In Dallas, both Texas-born Lyndon Johnson and UN Ambassador Adlai Stevenson have been physically assaulted. This Monday, November 18th, a warmer welcome greets Alabama's Governor George Wallace, bitter foe of school integration. Among his approving listeners is former General Edwin Walker, himself a spokesman for those who are darkly certain that the American dream is being betrayed, even by some elected leaders. With President Kennedy due on November 22nd, the Dallas City Council is stirred to action by the appearance of defamatory leaflets against the president. It passes an ordinance which outlaws all provocative acts interfering with free speech.
You have an ordinance as follows: it shall be unlawful for any person, singly or in concert with others, by use of insulting, threatening, or obscene language, to interfere with a public or private assembly, or seeking to interfere with, obstruct, or intimidate another in the exercising of his lawful right to speak at a public or private assembly.
Standing aye. Motion carried.
In a week without crisis, the president returns from Florida to a round of perfunctory official chores. He accepts a veterans group citation, confers with the ambassador from a new African state, also breakfasts with congressional leaders, talks with educators, and meets three West German essay winners. From poultry growers, he accepts a 55-pound Thanksgiving turkey, but insists on sparing the huge bird. "We'll just let this one grow," he says. "That'll be our Thanksgiving present to him." On the Wednesday night before the Texas trip, Supreme Court members are guests at an annual reception. Jacqueline Kennedy, for the first time since the loss of her infant son Patrick, joins her husband as official hostess. As the days move toward the president's visit on November 22nd, Dallas television monitors record a busy week. Almost unnoticed on Tuesday morning is Vice President Johnson's arrival by commercial airliner to address a bottlers' convention. On Thursday, he will join President Kennedy in San Antonio for his Texas tour. On Wednesday night, November 20th, the people of Dallas hear a special message from Police Chief Curry.
"Because of the unfortunate incident which occurred here during the visit of Ambassador Stevenson, people everywhere in the world will be hypercritical of our behavior. Nothing must occur that is disrespectful or degrading to the President of the United States. He is entitled to the highest respect of all of our citizens. And the law enforcement agencies in this area are going to do everything within their power to ensure that no untoward accident or incident occurs. We will take immediate action if any suspicious conduct is observed. And we also urge all good citizens to be alert for such conduct. It should be reported to officers immediately. These officers will be stationed at close intervals along the route that the president will travel. Citizens themselves may take action if it becomes obvious that someone is planning to commit an act that is harmful or degrading to the President of the United States."
On Thursday, November 21st, by White House helicopter, the President makes the familiar flight over the Capitol's parks and gray stone vistas to nearby Andrews Air Force Base. Forever shy of public hurly-burly, yet herself an incalculable political asset, Jacqueline Kennedy has decided to accompany her husband to Texas, their first such trip together since his election. Waiting is Air Force One, the designation given any plane the president flies. This morning, as usual, it is number 26,000. An airborne command post from which he can communicate with points around the earth. Its interior fitting supervised by Mrs. Kennedy, the sleek transport has carried the president nearly 75,000 miles. Fort Worth's Texas Hotel, where the President and Mrs. Kennedy will spend this Thursday night. Workmen and maids groom the presidential suite. For the President's comfort, they have installed a rocking chair, and near it, the President's special phone, that thin and constant thread which links him to Washington and presidential responsibility. Landing first in San Antonio at 2:30 Thursday afternoon, the President inspects a new aerospace medical center, which he has just dedicated at Brooks Air Force Base. At 3:30, he is again airborne for his next stop, Houston. His task? To unite wrangling members of his own party. Despite the surface show of harmony, a crackling feud between the state's Governor Connally and Senator Yarborough threatens to split the Texas Democrats into warring liberal and conservative camps. Aided by Vice President Johnson, the President works to forestall an irreparable break. This evening, the President will climax his political efforts by speaking at a banquet in Houston honoring local Congressman Albert Thomas. But before the speech, the President and his lady surprise a delighted gathering of Spanish-speaking citizens by an impromptu appearance.
Well, I'm glad to be here today, and in order that my words will be even clearer, I'm going to ask my wife to say a few words to you also.
Estoy muy contenta de estar en el gran estado de Texas, de estar con ustedes que forman parte de la noble tradición española que tanto ha contribuido a Texas. Esta tradición comenzó 100 años antes de que se colonizó Massachusetts, el estado de mi marido. Pero es una tradición que se mantiene viva y vigorosa.
¡Viva!
I would say it would be anticlimactic in the light of what this lovely, gracious lady has said. But I know that I speak for all of you when I say that we are very proud and very happy that we can have our beloved president and our first lady with us here this evening.
Away at the Texas Book Depository, Lee Harvey Oswald leaves at the end of the day's work. Catching a ride with fellow employee Wesley Frazier, he goes through the Triple Underpass on his way to visit his family, his first visit on a weeknight since he took the North Beckley Street room. En route, he passes the Trade Mart, where President Kennedy will address Dallas's prominent citizens at midday tomorrow. 30 minutes later, Oswald is in the suburb of Irving. There, his two small children and wife, Marina, live with Mrs. Ruth Payne, a Quaker woman who has befriended the family, and in October, even helped the improvident Oswald get his job at the book depository. Surprised by Oswald's visit on a weeknight, Mrs. Payne later will recall finding the light on in the garage, in which are stored some of the Oswald family's meager belongings. Among them, a rolled blanket containing, as Marina will remember, a rifle Oswald bought by mail order last March. That night, Lee Oswald goes to bed about 9:30. In downtown Dallas, early editions of the morning news again confirm tomorrow's presidential route and the time of his luncheon appearance, 12:30. In the trademark's inner court, workmen push last-minute preparations for the luncheon, while police and Secret Service agents make final security checks. As always, the president's phone is installed and ready. Also awaiting the president are two box saddles, gifts from Dallas to his children, Carolyn and John John. Elsewhere in Dallas, it is a lively evening. Along Commerce Street at the Carousel Club, some of the livelier arts are presented by its excitable impresario, Jack Ruby, a 52-year-old bachelor who aspires to the big time, cultivates influential connections, and admires class in all its forms. At the Baker Hotel, movie star Joan Crawford gives autographs, and in her capacity as bottling executive, joins the receiving line with another famed figure, former Vice President Richard Nixon, who wryly comments on the purpose of the president's visit.
Well, what I say is political. I'm not criticizing you for making the trip, but I think the purpose of the trip primarily is not the investigation of how the space program is going, but the purpose is to mend fences in Texas.
When I read the report that Congressman Thomas was thinking of resigning, I called him up on the phone and asked him to stay as long as I stayed. I didn't know how long that would be, but I wanted him to stay.
At 9:30 that evening, the president is still in Houston. After boosting Democratic Congressman Thomas in his banquet speech, President Kennedy praises the city's role in the accomplishments of the space program.
Next month, when the United States of America fires the largest booster in the history of the world into space for the first time, giving us the lead, fires the largest payload into space, giving us the lead. It will be the largest payroll, too. And who should know that better than Houston? Put a little of it right in here. But in any case, the United States next month will have a leadership in space, which you wouldn't have without Albert Thomas. And so will this city.
Afterward, he leaves at once for Fort Worth. Since 11 this morning, the president has flown over 2,000 miles, toured the streets of three cities, conferred with warring party chiefs, and made two major speeches. Tomorrow's schedule is as rigorous. There will be a breakfast speech in Fort Worth, a motorcade through downtown Dallas, a $100 plate dinner in Austin, and finally a 90-mile ride to the Vice President's ranch. But now, close to midnight, the President and Mrs. Kennedy get a brief respite as they retire at the Texas Hotel in Fort Worth to catch their breath in privacy. On Friday, November 22nd, Lee Harvey Oswald rises quietly and boils water for a quick cup of instant coffee. an hour later, without awakening anyone, he leaves the silent Payne household. Carrying a long paper-wrapped parcel, he walks the half block to Wesley Fraser's house for his ride to the book depository. Fraser's sister, Mrs. William Randall, watches him approach this morning.
About 7:10 a.m. in the morning, I was preparing lunches. I looked out the window and saw a man, whom I learned later was Mr. Oswald, crossing the street with a package approximately 2.5 feet long. He proceeded across my carport, and I opened the door to see where he was going and saw him put the package into my brother's car.
Minutes later, he is joined by Fraser.
I went out the back door. Lee was there standing just outside the door. We walked to the car. As we were getting in the car, I saw the package and I said, "What's the package, Lee?" Lee said, "Curtain rods." And the only comment that was made on the way to work was about the babies and the weather. And I always managed to get some comment out of him about children because I see he seemed like he's very fond of them. And I asked him, did he have fun playing with the babies? And he says, "Oh yeah," and kind of chuckled to himself.
Fifteen minutes after leaving the suburb of Irving, Wesley Fraser's 1953 Chevrolet sedan joins the flow of morning traffic speeding along Stennens Freeway toward the gray towers of downtown Dallas.
About the weather, and it was an 80 day, and we both said if it didn't clear up, it's sure gonna be a bad day.
It is nearing 8 o'clock when the drab bulk of the book depository looms up beyond the triple underpass. Here, the presidential motorcade is due to pass in 4.5 hours. As usual, Wesley Fraser drives his car to a distant employee parking lot beside a railroad yard, a four-block walk from the book depository's back entrance. But this morning, his companion is in a hurry.
And I said, "You get out of the car," see, "and pick up the package." When I was charging my battery, see. My battery ain't charging pretty bad. And then when I got out of the car and fixed the shut door, he started walking a little bit faster. And he finally got about 50 feet ahead of me.
Unlovely amid Dallas's splendid downtown structures, the depository is a textbook distribution center. Oswald's job, gathering books for shipment to Texas schools, gives him access to the building's 7 floors. In Fort Worth this morning, the president jokes with the crowd outside his hotel. Excusing Mrs. Kennedy's absence, he says it takes her longer to organize herself. But, he suggests, the result is worth the wait. At 9, he re-enters the hotel, where Chamber of Commerce breakfast guests have gathered.
I proudly present the President of the United States.
I know now why everyone in Texas, Fort Worth, is so thin, having gotten up and down about nine times. This is what you do every morning. 2 years ago, I said that, introduced myself in Paris by saying that I was the man who had accompanied Mrs. Kennedy to Paris. I'm getting that somewhat that same sensation as I travel around Texas. Nobody wonders what Lyndon and I wear. About 35 years ago, a congressman from California...
After a speech reciting gains in national defense, the president's schedule allows for a presentation by Raymond Buck, head of the Chamber of Commerce.
Mr. President, we know that you don't
wear a hat.
We couldn't let you leave Fort Worth without providing you with some protection against the rain.
In the White House on Monday. If you'll come up there, you'll have a chance to see it there.
And to protect you against local enemies in the manner that you are protecting this nation against our foreign enemies, and to keep the rattlesnakes on Vice President Johnson's ranch from striking you, we want to present this pair of boots. We won't ask you to put them on. Here.
Twin city rivalry between Fort Worth and Dallas now requires a small gesture to civic pride. The president must return to the Fort Worth airport and make the 30-mile hop to Dallas by the 600-mile-an-hour presidential jet. The president is in good spirits. The Texas trip is going well. Aside from an occasional hostile placard, the crowds are friendly. As he departs Fort Worth, eager citizens bask briefly in the presidential aura. Elsewhere, indifferent to Texas politicking, the nation drifts in a pre-Thanksgiving calm so free of alarm that Washington's top leaders can be absent at the same time. In Hawaii at this moment, a cabinet group led by Secretary of State Rusk resumes its flight to Japanese conferences. Along the eastern seaboard, sidewalks are crowded with people going to lunch. In Chicago, the first games of an international bowling meet get underway. On the Great Plains, ranchers have worked 3 hours since daybreak. Along the Pacific, children have just begun their classes. With holidays close by, it is hard to memorize dates and history, so remote and far away. But in Dallas, by special permission, the children are out of school. They join the crowd at Love Field, waiting to see the president. Already, a special cargo plane has arrived and unloaded the president's bubble-top convertible.
Depending on the weather, if it's nice weather, no rain, top would be down. So evidently, for all of you people who will see the parade downtown, you'll see a glimpse of the president and first lady in the flesh rather than through the bubble top glass on the outside. As the gendarme looks down over the crowd gathered, it's a warmed up crowd compared to what it was a short while ago before the sun broke through. Feels mighty good too, believe me. next big jet approaches.
Hey, President!
And this one should contain the President and Mrs. Kennedy.
Here comes Jack.
Here comes the big jet in. Dallas people, Governor and Mrs. Connolly. Governor Connolly on your left. Governor Connolly with his arm around the President. Kennedy backs up and waits for the President, who stops to chat with some of the people greeting him here. Crowd waving, as you can see. People standing up all over everything available to get a glimpse of the President and his wife. Cheering and yelling going on down the way as they approach the cars. Secret Service right along with the President, of course. The President passes right in front of a Dallas police officer, right in front of our cameras now. Somebody patted his shoulder. Mrs. Kennedy coming along behind him, grinning all the while. The President saying, thank you very much, if I may be permitted to read a presidential lip movement. This is a bonus for the people who have waited out here. And the President waves goodbye, waits for his wife, and back they go to the car. Governor Connolly standing in the car with a big 10-gallon hat on. Mrs. Kennedy stepping in the car first. Now the President, they both in the back seat now. Now the motorcade will very shortly start to move out. Car moving out. The President and First Lady. Big, beautiful Lincoln. Followed by Secret Service men, the car behind. Then comes the Vice President and Mrs. Johnson, Senator Yarborough. Dallas police out here in force today, doing a beautiful job of handling the crowd, along with a contingent of Texas Rangers. The party now is leaving Dallas Love Field. And, of course, as we say, thousands will be on hand for that motorcade now, which will be downtown Dallas, down Cedar Springs, to Harwood. And on Harwood, it'll turn on Main, from which point it'll go all the way down to the courthouse area, which is the end of Main. It'll turn on Houston Street to Elm under the Triple Underpass. After the march where the President talks at approximately 1 o'clock.
Near noon, the motorcade heads downtown. Its progress recorded by broadcasters' voices and camera amateurs.
Now here comes Jackie and Mr. Kennedy. Mrs. Kennedy radiant in that pink outfit and the pink hat. And of course, you can hear the streets around us. They're driving it plenty slow enough for the people on hand here to get a good look at them, to get a good wave in, and I'm sure that everybody would swear that they were waving directly at them.
It is
Lee Oswald's lunch hour. In less than 25 minutes, the president is scheduled to pass the depository. But as other employees go downstairs to see the president, Oswald stays on the sixth floor. He asks a fellow worker to arrange to send the elevator back up. Now, in the stillness of the deserted floor, a rifle is brought out, loaded, and carried to a corner window. There, carefully arranged book cartons will shield the assassin from view. But the assassin's view is excellent. Directly below, the president's car must turn, then angle toward the underpass. Amid the trademarked fountains and twittering parakeets in cages, Dallas's elites await the president's early arrival. Under security precautions, his luncheon steak will be selected at random from the 2,500 steaks to be served the guests. Despite some worried expectations, the Dallas crowds are so thick and friendly that the motorcade is slowed even before it reaches the downtown streets. Two cars behind the president, Vice President Johnson is concerned that their trademark arrival will be minutes behind the scheduled time of 12:30. Now, by the opened window, unsuspected on the depository's hushed sixth floor, the assassin listens for the sound of the motorcade. Turning from Maine to Houston, the president's car must approach the depository dead on, then turn again, just as another convertible might. And for 30 yards, the president himself will be easy to track on the four-power scope. Among the waiting crowds outside the trademark 4 miles away, a few spectators exercise their constitutional right to express a less friendly greeting.
The large police escort is now ahead of the presidential motorcade, just having now turned right-hand onto Main off of Harwood. And the crowd is surging forward to close in somewhat on the leading cars. There's a big cheer going up as the president gets further down. And now the ticker tape is beginning to flow from the windows all over the large buildings here and engulf the entire motorcade. Here comes the first car with Police Chief Jess Curry, and here is the President of the United States. And the crowd is absolutely going wild. This is a friendly crowd in downtown Dallas as the President and the First Lady pass by.
Now the assassin braces his weapon. In the cleared streets, only the target is missing.
Any fear that demonstrations may have marred the presidential motorcade here in the downtown area. At this point, however, seems useless. Crowds here seem to radiate a love for the president. The Dallas Police Department is working with a fully augmented force to dispel any fear that unfortunate incidents similar to those that accompanied UN Ambassador Adlai Stevenson's visit do not occur on this trip.
Rounding the end of Main Street, the president's car swings onto Houston toward the open window of the book depository. Beneath it, in a moment, the motorcade will turn toward the underpass.
police instructions, the lead cars race for Parkland Hospital, closely followed by the car in which a Secret Service agent shields the vice president with his body. At the depository, the motorcade lies shattered by the sudden unseen blow. As it falters on amid dazed and terrible questions, the nearest available police enter the building. Stopped at gunpoint in the lunchroom, Lee Oswald is immediately cleared as an employee, then quickly escapes the building unnoticed.
Dr. Shires.
Alerted by police radio, hospital emergency calls shatter lunch hour calm, while the car with the stricken president and governor careens to the emergency entrance. In still readiness, medicine's impartial apparatus waits. This time for the President of the United States. Led by Dr. Malcolm Perry, specialists converge on the emergency operating room. Within the hospital, security cloaks the Vice President as executive aides rush up, followed by breathless White House correspondents and a shaken personal staff. Already, minutes after the event, news services carry word of the shooting, grope at the dread possibilities.
So
in a Dallas television station, the news bursts upon a routine midday program.
And very often you'll find a zipper hidden in the arm.
You'll excuse me if I am out of breath. A bulletin, this is from the United Press from Dallas. President Kennedy and Governor John Connally have been cut down by assassins' bullets in downtown Dallas. They were riding in an open automobile when the shots were fired. The president, his limp body carried in...
Shocked by the television report, a priest at Holy Trinity Rectory gathers the articles of the Last Sacrament. Then, unsummoned, Father Oscar Huber hurries to the president he had watched pass through his parish 30 minutes ago. Police surround the book depository. One witness, Howard L. Brennan, reports having seen a man fire at the president's car from an upper window. Unlike other crowded vantage points, this offered surest privacy to an assassin. Amid the silent stacks of book cartons, the search begins for a clue, a weapon, anything. Outside, the police surge through the surrounding area in search of a sniper, rounding up other witnesses and suspects for questioning. Mainly on Brennan's report, a citywide police alert goes out for a slender white male, about 30 years old and 5 feet 10 inches tall.
What was a wonderful welcome in downtown Dallas has become a scene of indescribable horror as hundreds of people crowd outside the back door of the emergency room here at Parkland Hospital. And people are wondering, is our president going to live? President Kennedy is on the inside of Parkland Hospital, and two priests have just been sent in to the room with the president. Senator Ralph Yarbrough, a moment ago, told KILD News he saw a Secret Service man beating the rear of the car on which the president was riding with his fists, and he knew something horrible had happened. At present, reporters are being held outside the back door of Parkland Hospital, waiting some announcement, some word on the condition of the president.
In mortal premonition, the crowd at Parkland Hospital watches the president's belongings carried from the sealed-off convertible. Seven blocks from the shooting, Lee Oswald boards the number 30 Marcellus Street bus to his rooming house, heading toward the depository he has just left. When the bus fails to move in the paralyzed traffic, he gets off, then walks two blocks to the Greyhound bus terminal, where he hires the cab of William Whaley.
I picked up a fare at the Greyhound bus taxi cab stand. This young man told me that he wanted to go to the 500 block of North Beckley. And when he got in, police sirens was running, crisscrossing each other, and policemen on tricycles was running down. And so I thought it was a fire or a holdup or something. I asked him, I said, I wonder what the hell all this uproar is about. and he didn't answer me. So I figured he's one of these people, which we have lots of, that don't like to talk. They got other things on their mind. And so I just carried him on to where he wanted to go. So I carried him on across the viaduct, turned left to 500 block of North Beckley. And when I got over on North Beckley, coming on to the intersection of Neely, North Beckley, he said, this will do fine. I pulled over to the curb. The fare was 95 cents. He handed me a dollar bill and got out. Walked in front of my cab across the street, and that's the last I saw of him.
Having gotten out five blocks beyond his real destination, Lee Oswald backtracks the distance to the small North Beckley Street room he keeps as O.H. Lee. His rush into the house startles housekeeper Earlene Roberts, who will later recall that he leaves almost instantly in a different, lighter jacket.
At Parkland Hospital, this is Bob Huffaker for KILD. The First Lady is in the emergency room with the President, and the crowd outside is quiet and waiting for some word of the condition of the President.
Outside Parkland, in terrible helplessness, people wait. While in the hospital, doctors fight a battle already lost. At 1 o'clock, Friday, November 22nd, John Fitzgerald Kennedy is dead. Beyond view, White House aide Kenneth O'Donnell walks steadily 100 feet to another room. To Lyndon Johnson, he says, Mr. President, the President is dead. The crowd sees Mrs. Johnson depart, followed by the man who, unknown to it, now is President. The news of President Kennedy's death is withheld until the new President can be placed in the security of Air Force One. Even now, the great plane is being readied for instant return flight to Washington, where the Secret Service can more effectively guard the President against whatever threats may come. In the quiet Virginia countryside, a phone shrills, and word comes to Robert Kennedy that his bright companion, the President, his brother, is dead. Already, the nation's defenses have sprung into readiness. No one yet knows if the Dallas shooting is part of a wider plot. Signals alert United States forces everywhere, from Polaris submarines in distant seas to missile silos, whose baleful windows open to the sky.
In Parkland, Malcolm Kilduff, the assistant press secretary with the presidential party, made the announcement just a few moments ago. Kilduff started off saying, John F. Kennedy died at approximately 1 o'clock Central Standard Time today here in Dallas. Reporters ask him for other details. He says, I have no other details. He was asked, where is Vice President Johnson? Has he taken the oath of office? I do not know. At the moment, his movements are secret and will be in the future.
At 1:33 p.m., rumor and fear become fact. The President's death is officially confirmed. Trademark guests, here he will never arrive.
May we all stand for a moment? Sure, there's a desire in each of our hearts to bow our heads. The presence of Almighty God, when each in our own way would come to Him. We realize that this is a
with each gun, relying upon the faith that we possess.
In swift transfer, an instrument of power already belongs to another voice. In stunned Washington, younger brother Edward Kennedy gets word as he presides in the Senate. Political antagonisms forgotten, Majority Leader Mike Mansfield and Republican Leader Everett Dirksen stare in blank dismay. Aging House Speaker John McCormick faces the awesome fact he is next in line for the presidency. Ever sensitive to disaster, the New York stock market plunges downward 22 points in a wild surge of selling. And 1 hour a widow. Mrs. Kennedy leaves the hospital, still in shock, yet incredibly composed. As she returns to Washington with the body of her slain husband, Jacqueline Kennedy also begins her own lonely journey into the proud history of her country. At nearly the same time, Federal District Judge Sarah T. Hughes, an old friend of Lyndon Johnson's, is startled by a phone call from Air Force One. It summons her to swear in the new president. As she hurries to Love Field, Robert Kennedy conveys by phone to the plane instructions on the proper administration of the oath. The Bible to be used for the ceremony belonged to John F. Kennedy. At 1:22, as police throughout the city hunt for the suspected assassin described by Brennan, the searchers on the building's sixth floor find a rifle, a $20 6.5 Mannlicher Carcano with a four-power telescopic sight. It has been concealed near a stairway landing, directly opposite from the assassin's window. Also found are palm prints on the boxes stacked near the window and three spent shells, which quickly are fitted to the bolt-action rifle's firing chamber. Suddenly, to Dallas Police Headquarters comes word that an officer, J.D. Tippett, has been shot and killed in the Oak Cliff section on East 10th Street. Instantly, an alarm is broadcast for a police killer. In the quiet street, a few blocks from Oswald's rooming house, three witnesses tell police how Officer Tippett pulled over to the curb, then got from his patrol car to talk to his assailant, and was shot four times. Eight others have seen a man run through the area with a pistol. Later, they will identify Oswald as that man. Nearby, a light jacket is found. In full flight on Jefferson Boulevard, Lee Oswald takes refuge in a shoe store entrance, where he is noticed by salesman John Brewer.
I stand behind the counter listening to the radio Friday and heard on the radio that Officer Tippett had been shot. I heard sirens coming down Jefferson Street, and this man walked into the lobby of a store there, matching the description that they'd given out on the radio. The police cars made a U-turn and went back down Jefferson, and this man walked out up towards the Texas Theater.
Alerted by the radio description, John Brewer follows Oswald toward the nearby Texas Theater, where the second feature, a Korean War film, is on screen. Unnoticed, Lee Oswald slips past a distracted cashier and enters the dark, near-empty theater.
John! John, where are you? Get down! They're coming!
Unknown to Lee Oswald as he watches the film, John Brewer enlists the aid of the theater's manager, and together they block the theater's two exits. At the same time, the cashier hurriedly calls the police to report Officer Tippett's suspected killer. At Love Field on Air Force One, Jacqueline Kennedy briefly leaves her husband's coffin to stand beside Lyndon Johnson for the swearing-in ceremony, scratchily recorded for history on a dictaphone.
I do solemnly swear.
In his first command, the president orders the plane's instant takeoff. Pointed out by Brewer, Oswald is surprised by police in the Texas theater. There is a brief struggle as his pistol misfires. Then the suspected police killer is dragged from the theater, thrust into a car, and driven off to police headquarters. Now, as Air Force One races toward Washington with its tragic burden, Lyndon Johnson begins his presidency. By phone, he comforts the dead president's mother, then drafts a statement to the country. Below the plane, the news crosses the land like a vast shockwave. In anger or stunned incomprehension, the people seize newspapers or listen to endless confirmations of what they cannot yet believe in equally shocked statements from persons great and small.
The tragedy of this day is beyond any instant comprehension. And all of us who knew him will bear the grief of his death until the day of ours. And all men everywhere who love justice and freedom and peace will bow their heads.
I think this is the worst possible thing that could ever happen to our country at a time like this.
Something very hard to believe in this wonderful country of ours.
I felt as though I had lost a member of my family.
I share the sense of shock and dismay that the entire nation must feel at the despicable act that took the life of the nation's president.
I hope they get the assassins, and I hope that something is done to them. Far worse than killing them.
It reminded me of something like what happened to Lincoln.
He's the kind of an antagonist that I've always enjoyed. He would fight like a wildcat for his points and his principles, but there was never anything personal about it.
I think that we really lost someone that would have helped the future of this country quite a bit.
I'm so shocked, I just can't say anything.
I was very much shocked and hurt when I heard of the passing of the President of the United States. He was a good man, an able president, and he did a good job.
I think it's a tragedy for the whole world. I was very shocked. It's terrible. It's unbelievable.
Silences also speak. United Nations delegates bow in mute homage. Then, as the session is quickly adjourned, they press condolences on Adlai Stevenson and the United States mission. As word and picture are flashed overseas, countries around the world treat the United States tragedy as their own. It is night in London as the great black headlines jolt crowds outside the theaters. Silent throngs converge on the United States Embassy to watch the news bulletins. In Moscow, there is somber sadness as special newspaper editions are quickly made up. Radio Moscow plays only funeral music. People ask about the new president. Tonight, there is no Cold War. In Berlin, 5 months ago, John Kennedy declared, "Ich bin ein Berliner." Tonight, a handful of students carrying torches start toward the city hall steps where the president spoke. When they arrive, there are 60,000. But in America, under Air Force One's swift wings, this day has not yet ended. In Dallas police headquarters, Lee Oswald is booked for the slaying of Officer Tippett. Tight-lipped, bruised from his battle with his captors, he is led through a gauntlet of newsmen, and the world gets its first look at Lee Harvey Oswald, suspected police killer. But now, from articles in his pockets, police make the startling discovery that this is the missing book depository employee, and immediately send investigators to question his wife. As examination proves his pistol fired the shots killing Tippett, evidence swiftly mounts that he has committed this day not one murder, but two.
Here comes Oswald down the hall again.
You fire that rifle.
The facts that people have been given, but I emphatically deny these charges.
In Washington, across the street from the White House, a small crowd gathers in the afternoon seeking something it cannot name. On the back lawn, always in earshot of the executive office, the children's swings are still. For a moment, but a moment only, time pauses in this quiet room of presidents. Already, at nearby Fort McNair, death's orderly procedures have begun. On instructions from Air Force One, the Army's ceremonial chief, Paul C. Miller, sets in motion the vast preparations for a state funeral. Subject to Sergeant Shriver, the White House spokesman, ceremonies will be executed by the Military District of Washington under Major General Philip C. Wheel. As yet, it is known only that after repose in the White House, the president's body will lie in state at the Capitol. But plans are precise and detailed. The coffin, the widow and children, nation's leaders, military units. Each has an appointed place. At Fort Myer, men of the 3rd Infantry Regiment, the President's own, rehearse the solemn duties of the Death Watch. An honor guard of enlisted men, drawn from each of the armed services, will be posted about the president's coffin at all times. In Honolulu, another executive jet refuels after turning back from Japan in mid-flight on orders of Secretary Rusk. With 5 other cabinet members and Press Secretary Salinger, the plane quickly continues its flight to a stricken and uncertain Washington. A hush settles on the stock exchange as it halts the frenzied trading 83 minutes before regular closing. Gradually, the cities grow silent, streets emptied as if by plague or private sorrow. Without plan, businesses close, even a honky-tonk in Dallas. At its television screens, the greatest audience in history watches in stricken fascination the tragedy which is also its own. Through his campaigns and his presidency, television has made John F. Kennedy a familiar guest in every home. Now the day of his death will be related in cruel detail and endless repetition by the strangely assorted persons who have been witnesses to it.
We got such a good view from here. Could see him just even as he turned the corner. He was smiling and waving at the crowd.
The crowd couldn't have been more wonderful, more generous in their reaction to the president. And I just had such a good feeling about the way they had received him in this city. I had just turned around and said to him, "You can't say Dallas doesn't love you, Mr. President."
I turned onto Elm Street. Whenever we heard the first shot, I thought it was a motorcycle backfired.
And the president kind of raised up in his seat, and I thought, you know, he was kind of going along with a gag or something.
And he slumped to the side like this. Then I had another shot or two. I couldn't say what it was, one or two. And I saw his head practically open up.
Well, he was covered with a sheet, but I removed it just about as far as, I'd say, halfway down his face in order that I might administer the rites of the church to him.
Before we put the president in his casket, the president's wife placed her, took her wedding band. It looked to be like her wedding band off of her finger and put it on the president's and kissed his hand.
When I called the office, I was told that the vice president of the United States wanted me to come out to the airport and swear him in as president.
But when I got the telephone call about the president being killed, I walked over here and turned the television on, and the door opened, and he come in a hurry. And I said, "Who are you in a hurry?" He never parted his lips and went to his room, got a short coat and put on, and went out and to the bus stop. And that's the last I saw of him.
Finally, we received information he was in the Texas Theater. We went to this location, surrounded it from the outside, and then about eight officers, including one FBI agent and some uniform officers, went into the location and subdued the suspect, disarmed him, handcuffed him, put him in a car, went to the station, and turned him over to Captain Fritz in the Homicide Bureau.
My name is Lee Harvey Oswald, OSWALD.
Washington lies still in the November dusk. A weak storm front promises rain. And at Andrews Field, the nation by television awaits the homecoming of two presidents. Here also stand the men of Washington, White House aides, congressional leaders, judges and diplomats, each in silent separation, waiting for Air Force One to emerge from the dark. Tense train transfixes the silent gallery. On the cargo lift, in the glare of lights, the bronze coffin is an incredible, brutal truth. An honor guard moves to carry the coffin to a waiting ambulance. But the longtime aides of the dead president insist on performing this last service themselves. In the pitiless lights, Jacqueline Kennedy appears, an incongruously tragic figure in the pretty pink suit that this morning dazzled Texas crowds. Although a limousine stands by for her, she determinedly remains near her husband for the journey to the Naval Hospital at Bethesda, Maryland. Before the gaze of a shaken country, the new president now appears. He has been thrust into power by the cruelest conceivable circumstance. Yet, in his first public utterance, provides strong assurance that the nation's leadership continues.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
This is a sad time for all people. We have suffered a loss that cannot be weighed. For me, it is a deep personal tragedy. I know that the world shares the sorrow that Mrs. Kennedy and her family bear. I will do my best. That is all I can do. I ask for your help and God's.
Told of waiting congressional leaders, Lyndon Johnson turns back to greet the old colleagues, political foes and friends alike, with whom he has worked throughout his career. Then he joins advisors for the short flight to the White House and an immediate briefing on the world's trouble zones. In an upper room at Bethesda Naval Hospital, Jacqueline Kennedy stays sleepless in the night hours as her husband's body is prepared for burial. Around her rally his old staunch friends, Larry O'Brien, Dave Powers, and Kenny O'Donnell, who recovers and returns the ring she placed on her husband's hand. At the White House's South Lawn, the new president arrives and approaches the great house he will now occupy. Goes into the West Wing through the silent cabinet room where henceforth he will preside. Another office, the president's, he does not enter. Instead, he goes this night to his old vice presidential rooms in the executive office building across the street. There, with swift and fluent precision, he begins the immediate task of steadying the nation. At once, in rapid succession, the presidential calls go out. He seeks support from former Presidents Truman and Eisenhower, calls business leaders, meets congressmen and White House aides. But before Lyndon Baines Johnson leaves his office at 9 o'clock, he writes his first letters as president to two children, Carolyn and John Kennedy Jr. Displayed in Dallas, the death weapon is itself destroying Lee Oswald's jerry-built defenses. It is traced to a purchaser named A. Hiddell, an alias on an identification card Oswald carries. Palm prints and a strand of clothing connect him to the weapon. In willing testimony, his wife, Marina, reveals that Oswald owned such a rifle and that it now is missing. Through her, police are led to the North Beckley rooming house, where they find other incriminating material. As the evidence accumulates and the public becomes aware of the increasing police suspicions, Lee Oswald is shuttled back and forth through the corridors of police headquarters to face witness after witness. He also is brought into a wild and noisy press gathering where the police permit a few questions.
I really don't know what the situation is about. Nobody has told me anything. Except that I'm accused of murdering the police. I know nothing more than that, and I do request for someone to come forward to give me a legal assistance.
Did you kill the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet. The first thing I heard about it was when the newspaper reporters in the hall asked me that question.
Yet for all of Lee Oswald's denials, direct or indirect, investigators reach an opposite conclusion revealed by District Attorney Henry Wade.
He's been charged with both killing Officer Tiffin and John F. Kennedy.
How long ago was he charged? With the president's killing.
11:26, he was. Was that 11:26? He was charged on the latter charge. I figure we have sufficient evidence to convict him.
Later, the gun and other evidence is sent to Washington for tests by the FBI. At his home in a Washington suburb, President Johnson excuses his aides and retires. Then, restless, He again rouses them to talk and plan until 3:30 in the morning. Even in tragedy, the nation's unsparing needs will not wait. At nearly 4:30 on Saturday morning, led by a Marine honor guard, John Kennedy comes home for the last time. They bear the president to the East Room, where he and his lady have graced the history of this house with gay and lustrous gatherings. Now, in final tenancy, they will ennoble it. At an accelerating pace, the preparations of the military district continue throughout the night. A great funeral takes form, an immense ceremony covering 3 days. 7,000 men of all services will march in its processions or stand at 10-pace intervals along the streets. The Lincoln catafalque must be erected in the rotunda. Shells brought from arsenals for the cannon salutes. 48 minutes allowed for the caisson to travel from White House to Capitol at 100 steps a minute. No mistake can be permitted to flaw its solemn grandeur.
As you see, the family is here. The Special Honor Guard, the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff are located here. The first one to move will be the Special Honor Guard. They will wheel out and take this position here in the lead going up the front with General Weedley, Escort Commander, in the lead here. And following which will be the National Color. As the casket moves in, it will move in a counterclockwise direction around to the west entrance, back on.
Saturday, the morning breaks wet and gray, and the nation labors with its anguish. Even now, by old habit, the mind still sees the president in life, stubbornly resists yesterday's terrible noon. But always, implacably, reality prevails. Youngest elected president, soonest to die, he lies now where 100 years ago Lincoln lay. Already, as private services end, the White House staff files by. In Hyannisport, Rose Kennedy leaves Mass with her son Edward, finally to tell the slain president's invalided father the dark news which has been withheld. Within the hour, Joseph Kennedy mourns his third child to meet violent death. This morning, on Jacqueline Kennedy's behalf, Robert Kennedy leads a small party to Arlington Cemetery to confer on the president's possible interment there. Three burial sites are considered, one at Dewey Circle, another situated near the Memorial Amphitheater at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldiers, and a third, later chosen by Mrs. Kennedy, which lies on a slope overlooking the Capitol he loved. Crossing to his old offices after an early briefing in the White House Situation Room, President Johnson is symbol of the nation's stability in sorrow. Now, as president, he confers with Secretary of State Rusk, whose plane returned to the Capitol during the night. Then meets with Defense Secretary McNamara. As if a key to his intended policies, he asks the Kennedy team to remain.
These people have given me a hearing without legal representation or anything. I didn't shoot anybody.
Lee Harvey Oswald. Who lives behind that face? A pretty child born in 1939 in New Orleans to a widowed mother. A laughing five-year-old between his brothers, already a veteran of more than a year in a boarding institution. a pleased second grader in Fort Worth, where his mother parts from her third husband. A failing schoolboy swept by gusts of rage, without roots in family or place. A teenage truant in New York City, for whom a court-appointed psychiatrist urges therapy, which he never gets. His mother, Marguerite Oswald, tells Lee's probation officers to keep out of family affairs. At 17, a troublesome Marine, he is found through Karl Marx a focus for his hates. Discharged in 1959, Oswald goes to Moscow, there dramatically renounces his native land. He marries a young pharmacist. Soon after, friendless and disillusioned, he begs to return home. But back in the United States, Lee Oswald is as bitter and unsettled as ever. He gets a little attention in New Orleans by passing out pro-Castro leaflets. In March 1963, he buys a second-hand rifle by mail order. Unhappy, he drifts from job to job. New Orleans, Fort Worth, Dallas. Acquaintances back away from his abuse. There are rumors of marital tension. That spring, as if for history, Lee Oswald asks Marina to take his picture. He seems surer now, his hate needing only a target of opportunity. By incredible chance, the target will be the President of the United States. Even now, he seems unshaken. Adamantly, he denies all charges, endures the repeated marches through the headquarters hallway with the air of a sullen martyr. But the case against him continues to tighten hour by hour, as Police Chief Curry reports to the press.
How long has he been under questioning now?
I don't know exactly how long he's been under questioning. It's been intermittent. It has not been continuous.
But so far, he's given absolutely no sign of weakening under the questioning?
No.
Are you and the rest of the police convinced you have the right man now?
I think we do.
Are there any other suspects linked with Oswald?
No.
For Jack Ruby, grieving in his Dallas apartment, the president's death is an insufferable personal calamity. Sobbing, he feels compelled to call friends and relatives as far away as Detroit. Watching television, he is outraged by the suspect's seeming arrogance. In growing agitation, he repeatedly calls the Times-Herald amusement editor, Don Safran, to remind him that he has closed his club in patriotic tribute. Across Washington's rain-swept cobblestones, into the storage bins of history, pass President Kennedy's office furnishings, warmly familiar mementos of a man and an era that ended only yesterday. Already, by strict order of protocol, the distinguished mourners come. Among them, former President Eisenhower and Chief Justice Warren. In Moscow, at the United States Embassy, another important mourner arrives. Welcomed by Ambassador Foy Kohler, Chairman Nikita Khrushchev solemnly signs the embassy's book of condolences. Through all the Iron Curtain lands except Red China, the people pay homage to the president who so often asserted the common human needs that bind nations above their differences. In Ireland, Mrs. Mary Ryan mourns a cousin who stopped for tea 5 months ago.
Mrs. Ryan, did you send any special message to Mrs. Kennedy?
Yes, this morning.
What was in the message?
Oh, with deep regret.
In England's Westminster Abbey, the great tenor bell tolls each minute from 11 till noon, an honor only accorded kings. A famed satirical program also pays tribute.
The reason why the shock was so great, why when one heard the news last night, one felt suddenly so empty, was because it was the most unexpected piece of news one could possibly imagine. It was the least likely thing to happen in the whole world. If anyone else had died, Sir Winston Churchill, De Gaulle, Khrushchev, it would have been something that somehow we could have understood and even perhaps accepted. But that Kennedy should go, well, we just didn't believe in assassination anymore. Not in the civilized world, anyway.
When Kennedy was elected 3 years ago, it was as if we'd all been given some gigantic, miraculous present. Suddenly, over there in Washington, was this amazing man who seemed so utterly right for the job in every way that we took him completely for granted. Whenever we thought about the world, we had that warm image at the back of our minds of a man who would keep everything on the rails. Now suddenly that present has been taken away from us when we thought we had still 5 more years before we need to start worrying again.
A young man rode with his head held high under the Texas sun, and no one guessed that a man so blessed would perish by the gun. The shot rang out like a sudden shout, and heaven held its breath, for the dreams of a multitude of men rode with him to his death.
In Washington, it is long after midnight when lights go on in the Library of Congress. On urgent request from the State Department, library staff members descend to the subterranean stacks, seeking useful details from contemporary news accounts of the military funerals of other presidents, particularly that of Abraham Lincoln. At Fort Myer, near Arlington Cemetery, men ready the black draped caisson which has borne President Franklin Roosevelt and the unknown soldier. Drawn by matched gray horses, it will carry President Kennedy's flag-covered casket in final processions through the Capitol. Blackjack, a 16-year-old chestnut gelding, is prepared for his ritual role. By ancient tradition, going back to the days of Genghis Khan, a fallen warrior is followed by his comparison horse. In the silver stirrups of the saddle, never again to be occupied, the boots are reversed. In the saddle scabbard, the sword is forever sheathed. Men of the famed 3rd Infantry Regiment, the Old Guard, also prepare. This proud unit, whose 39 battle streamers span the nation's history, now is the Capitol's shield and ceremonial unit. In faultless order, it has served President Kennedy often. Now it readies itself to serve him one more time. To pace the funeral's long and somber marches, even the spirited rattle of the drums must be muffled. By old military custom, drum heads are loosened and the drums shrouded in black. In Dallas this Sunday morning, an unsettled Jack Ruby leaves his apartment. Since Friday, on various pretexts, he has wormed his way into police headquarters, even has observed Oswald at close range. Now, about to go downtown, he still broods over the seeming irony of the protection given the suspected assassin. About 11 a.m., Ruby wires $25 to a needy stripper in Fort Worth. A few minutes later, carrying a small gun, he will enter the police headquarters basement less than a block away. In Washington's chill sun, images of grief cast shadows. The caissons horsemen, the silent drums, the White House like a serene presiding presence, the state's flags fluttering along the drive, a great panoply waiting, as if for some final act of purification. In Dallas, it is 11:20. Under heavy guard, Lee Oswald is being moved from police headquarters to the county jail. Made the big time. He has committed murder before an audience of millions. He has mocked law, robbed history of the truth, stained a nation already humbled. For this, it will be said, he expected praise. Aghast at what they have witnessed, reporters watch an unconscious Lee Oswald hurriedly wheeled to a waiting ambulance. The single bullet from Jack Ruby's gun has ripped through his midsection. Rushed to Parkland Hospital, Oswald is carried into the emergency section where President Kennedy died 2 days ago. Once again, as he had with the president, Dr. Malcolm Perry seeks desperately to keep Oswald's heart beating. He almost succeeds. Almost. At 1:07 p.m., Sunday, November 24th, Lee Harvey Oswald is dead. Forever silent, Lee Oswald's guarded corpse is wheeled away. Although condemned by overwhelming evidence, only he might have revealed when and why the fearful crime took shape in his twisted mind. At last, in Washington, a nobler drama takes command. Led by the slim, dark figure of Jacqueline Kennedy, there now begin those measured steps by which the nation bears its fallen presidents into history. Pennsylvania Avenue, the drums go by, 100 beats a minute. Behind them, the caisson goes to the Capitol, where John Kennedy received power 3 years ago. The Capitol steps, a cluster of dark-clad figures, wait for traditional military honors to be accorded the dead president before he is taken into the rotunda to lie in state. Six steps to the rotunda, the coffin bearers strain under their burden. A watching nation lifts it with them. Few will forget Jacqueline Kennedy this day. Transfigured by sorrow, she stands erect before the world's gaze and makes of her public ordeal an enduring testament of proud devotion. Now, through all the chill hours until the rotunda doors must close tomorrow, the unnamed mourners come, for there has been a death in the family. For 21 hours, there is a ceaseless whisper of feet across the rotunda's stone floor as 250,000 persons answer an unspoken mandate. From near and far away, they come by foot or car or chartered bus or plane. A family from Michigan, students from Connecticut, a naval lieutenant from Kentucky, until the line outside stretches eight abreast for 40 blocks. To each, it seems the indispensable personal gesture. From around the world, planes bring leaders of great states, ancient monarchies and nations just born. Anastas Mikoyan, first Deputy Premier of the Soviet Union. Queen Federica of Greece, subdued and pale. Charles de Gaulle, President of France, himself target of attempted assassination. Prince Philip and Prime Minister Douglas Hume of England. Ludwig Erhard, new Chancellor of West Germany. Proud Haile Selassie, Emperor of Ethiopia. In a barracks hallway at Fort Myer, bearers from all services rehearse a final act of military burial, folding the stars and stripes above the casket into the triangular cockade, symbol of the American Revolution. The flag, by ritual courtesy, will be given to Jacqueline Kennedy. In Monday's light, the statues wait. A nation's pride has made marble of its memories, created a past of stone. But still, John Kennedy remains a close and painful human presence. In a Senate memorial service this morning, old colleague Margaret Chase Smith lays a single red rose on the desk he occupied. In a brief and desolate ceremony, another funeral is held in a Fort Worth cemetery. Even in death, forever alienated from mankind, Lee Oswald is carried to his grave by hastily chosen volunteer newsmen, mourned only by his wife, an older brother, and his mother. In all the caissons' ceremonial journeys, Mrs. Kennedy returns from Capitol to White House, there to join the gathered dignitaries for the procession to St. Matthew's Cathedral. Amid tolling bell and the bagpipe's dirge, black-veiled like some ritual figure of classic myth, Jacqueline Kennedy follows her husband's coffin on foot, leading the greatest assemblage of world statesmen to pay homage in half a century. St. Matthew's, brought by car, the children join Mrs. Kennedy. Today is John John's third birthday. Across the land, a great silence falls. Trains halt. planes wait on the runways. All traffic ceases. The hushed streets become open chapels. For 5 minutes, in cities all over America, people pay silent tribute wherever they may be. Matthews, where the president prayed, an old friend and spiritual counsel prays for him. Like some great craggy archangel, Richard Cardinal Cushing officiated at John Kennedy's wedding, baptized his children, presided at the funeral of his son Patrick, and prayed at his inauguration. In phrase and cadence that speak of the oldest mysteries, of sacrifice and judgment and promise of life eternal, Cardinal Cushing intones the Requiem Mass. Rooted in man's beginning and his ancient search for conciliation with death, it is spoken for the dead, but addressed to the living. Around the earth, like a great murmuring concourse, other men also pray. In many lands and languages and religions, in public ritual or in the heart's private stillness, they mourn the young president who had sought to make reason and peace prevail. Kennedy begins its final journey to Arlington. Listening limousine stretches 3 miles through soundless throngs. Dark against the classic white block of the Lincoln Memorial, the procession crosses the Potomac into Arlington. Here, with his small son 12 days ago, President Kennedy honored the nation's heroic dead. Now, amid the orderly rows upon the hill, he returns to join their company forever. Gravesite comes death's great retinue of those who shared his life. Wife and family, cardinal, emperor, president, general, friend and rival, mourners all. 50 fighter jets for 50 states salute the commander-in-chief. And then, Air Force One.
I am the resurrection and the life. He who believeth in me, although he be dead, shall live. And everyone who liveth and believeth in me shall not die forever. God have mercy on us. Christ have mercy on us. God have mercy on us.
As the gun salutes and the lonely calls ring out in the waning autumn afternoon, a man and a time pass forever into the nation's history. The mourners depart. Millions of others will come in time ahead, for John Kennedy's bold words often reminded the nation of its most splendid self, and for that many loved him. He had spoken of great purposes and great ends, and we knew he was again voicing the promises the nation had made to itself long ago, when its own youth had just begun and everything was possible.